This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
السفارة العراقية في إيران لم يتخلف عن موعد توديع عبد العزيز الحكيم.
Dozens of Iraqis and Iranians gather today in front of the Iraqi embassy in Tehran to bid farewell to the head of the Iraqi Supreme Islamic Council, Abdul Aziz al-Hakim. The body of the Shiite leader, who died yesterday after a long battle with lung cancer, will be taken to the city of Qom, then to Iraq, where another funeral procession will be held for him before he is laid to rest in his hometown of Najaf. Fahima Mazani reports.
Dozens of people gathered here in the streets of Wali Asr, Tehran's biggest street leading to the Iraqi embassy. Most of the mourners were members of the Iraqi community who came out to take part in the funeral procession that was held for the head of the Iraqi Supreme Council of the Islamic Revolution, Abdul Aziz al-Hakim. Al-Hakim spent nearly 25 years living in exile in Iran after he was expelled from Iraq by the former regime. After returning to Iraq, al-Hakim occasionally visited Iran for political or medical reasons. During the past 28 months, al-Hakim fought a long and bitter battle with cancer. He was admitted to an Iranian hospital where he died yesterday.
The death of Mr. al-Hakim, who played a leading role on the Iraqi political front, is a major loss to Iraq. One would hope that our Iraqi brothers and political leaders will help heal the nation and uphold its spirit, cooperation, and unity. God willing, we will be compensated for this loss that came upon us.
Today, the streets of Tehran were prepared for the Shiite leader's funeral procession, allowing him to pass through Tehran one last time. Al-Hakim's body will be carried from the Iraqi embassy to the city of Qom, Iran's Islamic center, and then to Iraq, where he will be laid to rest in his hometown of Najaf. The man whose death was described as a major loss to Iraq by the Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki will receive two funeral processions, one in Iran and one in Iraq, in a move being described as symbolic. Al-Hakim spent his life relocating between the two countries.
The Iranian presidential elections and the waves of protests that have followed continue to raise questions over the groups behind them. Meanwhile, the Iranian Supreme Leader Ayatollah Ali Khamenei said in a meeting with university students that the opposition-led protests last June were premeditated. Khamenei, however, said that he doesn't believe that those leaders are spies working on behalf of foreign powers. In response to a question asked by a student regarding the decision not to arrest opposition leaders, Khamenei said that one can't react to false accusations and rumors, but he must act on facts and clear evidence. Meanwhile, French President Nicolas Sarkozy warned Iran of new sanctions if it doesn't respond to the special proposals offered by the Western nations to resume talks over its nuclear program. During a speech before the Élysée conference, Sarkozy said they have not received any positive response and they must recommend further sanctions if Iran doesn't change its policy.
The Israeli newspaper Haaretz reported that the U.S. administration has agreed to the Israeli government's demand to exclude East Jerusalem from special negotiations on freezing settlement construction.
The newspaper cited Israeli officials and Western diplomats saying that the American envoy to the Middle East, George Mitchell, recognizes that Benjamin Netanyahu will not agree to declaring a freeze on settlement construction in East Jerusalem. Mitchell will visit Israel during the second week of next month to conclude an American-Israeli agreement about the issues of settlements.
تعود قضية استمرار بناء المستوطنات الإسرائيلية في القدس الشرقية للواجهة.
The issue of continuing the construction of Israeli settlements in East Jerusalem has taken center stage and is strongly influencing events. The Israeli newspaper Haaretz referenced Israeli and Western sources, saying that the American administration that speaks a great deal these days about a Middle East settlement has retreated from its demand for a freeze on settlement construction in neighborhoods and outposts in East Jerusalem. The newspaper said that the American envoy to the Middle East, George Mitchell, who met with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and his government staff more than once, affirmed the reality that Netanyahu will never agree to declaring a freeze on settlement construction in East Jerusalem. Based on that, Washington agreed to remove the issue from any negotiations pertaining to settlements, despite its disapproval of these settlements. Therefore, Washington will be satisfied with an Israeli declaration about a settlement freeze only in the West Bank. Meanwhile, the Israeli group Har Amim, which opposes settlement construction in East Jerusalem, warned in one of its reports that since the first half of this year, an additional 250 residential units were built in settlements around the Old City. The Israeli group characterizes this as part of a strategic and systematic plan by the Israeli government. They say that on several occasions, these settlements have cut off Palestinian neighborhoods from each other, and that they directly affect the lives of the population.
هذه المستوطنات أوصال الأحياء الفلسطينية وتمس مباشرة حياة السكان.
The Israeli Prime Minister has already made his suggestion to the U.S. envoy during their meeting on Wednesday in London about a settlement freeze in the West Bank for 9 months while the construction of 2,500 residential units resumes. The final agreement between the U.S. and Israel about settlements has still not been concluded. However, features of this future agreement are already clear. The two sides will exchange views in Washington this coming week, and they will conclude an agreement the second week of September when the U.S. envoy George Mitchell returns to Israel.
استقبل الفلسطينيون في قطاع غزة شهر رمضان المبارك في أجواء تختلف.
The people in the Gaza Strip are experiencing Ramadan among circumstances that differ from the rest of the Arab and Muslim world. The blockade and the closure being imposed on the Gaza Strip in the past 3 years has had a negative impact on the local markets. The low supplies and high prices of goods have prevented many families from meeting the requirements of the holy month of Ramadan.
كثير من العوائل من أجواء هذا الشهر الفضيل.
لرمضان في قطاع غزة شكل آخر.
Ramadan in the Gaza Strip has a different face, a somber face, similar to those of the besieged people of the Gaza Strip. Life in the Gaza Strip is much harder during the month of Ramadan than during any other time of the year. If you go shopping at one of the marketplaces in the Gaza Strip, you will be shocked by the high prices of consumers' goods, including the prices of produce. The soaring prices are further straining life in the Gaza Strip, which has been placed under siege for the past 3 years.
The general situation in Gaza is very tragic. The unemployment rate is very high. Most people can't find work. They go to the marketplace just to window shop. Most people can't afford to buy anything.
People who have money can afford to buy things for Ramadan. However, those who don't have money are forced to economize and buy what little things they can afford. Most people have large families and don't have enough money to meet their daily needs. Hence, they only buy a few things for Ramadan.
This is the situation in the local marketplace. What about inside Palestinian homes? The situation here is much more harsh and bitter. This prompted us to bring Al Alam cameras to this residence, where we documented the suffering of a Palestinian family, a family that has been robbed by the occupation. This family has been robbed of their joy of celebrating the holy month of Ramadan. The family's head of household, who is sick and unemployed, told us he couldn't meet the minimum living requirements of Ramadan. Meanwhile, his wife says she feels anguish every time she talks about her family's ordeal.
Ramadan came at a very difficult time. We don't go shopping because everything is expensive. I didn't buy anything for Ramadan because I can't afford it. The children keep asking me to buy them things, but I can't do it. May God provide for us so I can buy something for the children.
The head of the household spends most of his time thinking of ways to help provide food for his children during the blessed month of Ramadan.
Our living conditions are very bad. I can't afford to buy anything for my children. No one cares. I can't meet the children's demands. They asked me for notebooks, but I told them I couldn't afford them. I'm tired of this situation. I'm also ill.
Although Abu Thaer was able to say a few words, the pictures drawn on the faces of the members of his family were clear enough to show their level of misery and the hardship of their lives. A harsh living reality was witnessed in this home, where a family was prevented from celebrating the holy month of Ramadan. While the world is celebrating the sweet festivities of Ramadan, the people of Gaza continue to live under painful and bitter conditions that seem to be intensifying with the Israeli siege. Isra Abahasi, Al Alam, from the beach camp, Gaza.
While the UN warns of high-level threat of Taliban attacks in Pakistan's Swat Valley, Islamabad claims they have now driven out the militants from this tribal area. Our correspondent Javed Rana takes a closer look.
Overall humanitarian situation.
The UN mission base in Pakistan, in its latest fact-finding report, has noted that the return of internally displaced tribal people to Swat Valley has slowed down, as the threat of militancy is still far from over despite army operation against the pro-Taliban militants.
The high-level mission led by the UN observed continued evidence of high-level security concerns in several areas of the district where the insurgent groups are still carrying out sporadic attacks and disturbing the population and thereby obstructing the return, the safe and secure return of the IDPs.
The UN has pointed out that apart from the threat of insurgency, heavy deployment of Pakistani security forces has also contributed to discourage people from going back to Swat Valley. The UN also sees some encouraging signs of life returning to normal in parts of Swat despite numerous hurdles. The UN noted that 90% of 1.7 million displaced people have already returned home. But still, many of the services in health and education sectors remain disrupted.
The facilities that are there are 75, of which 25 were partially damaged and 4 completely destroyed. 25 of the facilities are not operational because they are located in less secure zones, and these are the facilities are in the area of Kabul and Mata.
Infrastructure facilities have been substantially damaged after military launched extensive operation against the pro-Taliban militants in April this year. The UN, however, is to complete its final assessment by the end of September this year on how much damage the military operation has caused to the infrastructure in the region. Many fear the large-scale damage to the public properties may have some political implications.
They're going to first see who destroyed their properties, because if it is big collateral damage, there will be a big reaction. They will slowly, the Taliban will come back and say, your real enemy is not us. It is the people who have opened up artillery and firepower against your houses and villages. Did we open it up against you? They are going to ask that question.
In anticipation of possible military operation in South Waziristan, the last stronghold of Taliban, the UN has set up logistical facilities outside the southern belt of the tribal areas to possibly accommodate massive influx of refugees. However, despite American pressure, Pakistan military says that for the time being, it has no plan to launch ground operation in the toughest mountainous terrain as long as the US does not provide
surveillance equipments. Javed Rana, Press TV, Islamabad.
Three more NATO soldiers have been killed in separate attacks in Afghanistan. Two of the fatalities are American. NATO says one of them was slain when an improvised explosive device blew up in the south, while hostile fire killed the second one in the east of the country. The third soldier's identity has not been revealed yet, but it is believed that he is British. 2009 has become the deadliest year for foreign soldiers in Afghanistan since the US-led invasion. 8 years ago, close to 300 NATO troops have been killed so far this year. Almost a fifth of them have been slain this month alone.
Hi, I'm John Hamilton, breaking in for just a few seconds to ask for your support. You know, television is expensive to produce, and while the team at Mosaic brings you this vital daily news program on a shoestring compared to other networks, the reality is that we still need to raise $200,000 to keep Mosaic strong till the end of the year. Well, each year at this time, we turn to you for that support. You haven't let us down before. So please, let's keep world news from the Middle East alive and strong for another year. You can give online at linktv.org or call us at 1-866-485-8848. And thanks so much for sustaining Mosaic on Link TV.
في اليمن توقعت مصادر قريبة من اللجنة الأمنية أن يكون ممثل الحوثي في اتفاقية الدوحة صالح هبرة.
According to sources closely associated with the Supreme Security Committee, the Houthi representative in the Doha conference, Saleh Habra, was killed last Tuesday by Yemeni airstrikes in Saada.
في محافظة صعدة خلال أسابيع واصفا إياهم بالعصابات التي تقتل النساء.
As President Ali Abdullah Saleh vowed to eliminate the Houthis within weeks, saying that they are gangs that kill women and children, military forces have managed to open some roads that were closed by rebel forces in Saada and Harb Sufyan district in Amran province.
The sixth war between the Yemeni forces and Houthi rebels is leading to new developments. The Yemeni Defense Ministry announced that the army has managed to secure a number of roads in Dahta, southern Magdesh, the province of Saada, and the district of Harf Sufyan after they were previously shut down by the Houthis. The Supreme Security Committee said that the military operations will not be suspended until the rebels agree to the six conditions that the government has demanded before ending military operations. The Air Force is launching wide-scale strikes in Dahyan, Al-Mahda, Anad, Al-Khabji, and Matra, the stronghold of the rebel leader Abdel Malik al-Houthi. Also, violent clashes are taking place in the area of Harf Safyan. The army is intensifying mortar shells and missile attacks in the area to open the main road leading to Saada. Government sources said that the main road between Saada and Sana'a is still closed by the Houthis, who use landmines and guerrilla warfare to prevent the army from transporting military supplies. However, the army has managed to transport military supplies to the western war front in Al-Malahit area. The army also made advances in the province of Shadda, Razih, and the mountains of Maran. The two sides used hit-and-run techniques, but the government forces have managed to take control of some locations. Sources closely associated with the Supreme Security Committee in Sana'a said that the Al-Houthi representative in the Doha agreement, Saleh Habra, was killed last Tuesday when Yemeni planes attacked an oil station in the area of Talah in Saada. The Houthi rebels said that they deterred an attack by government forces in the northern areas after fierce battles in the past days. This comes as the army is changing its techniques to deal with guerrilla warfare. Perhaps the involvement of the Amalika or Giants Brigades in the war reflects a change in the course of the battle. This was pointed out by President Ali Abdullah Saleh, who said that the battle will be over within weeks. There is an increase in fuel prices in the local market, while worldwide prices witnessed a sharp decrease this week. This report presented by our colleague Basil Al-Aridi.
The increase in oil prices makes most Lebanese people wish that they had one of these, or even this, provided that this will quench the thirst of their cars. The local market is sufficient for consumption and gas meters are working all day long. However, the ministry did not lower the prices accordingly.
Under these conditions, life is hard. The people are waiting for the state to decrease taxes, and they are collecting. Instead of taking 10,000 Lebanese liras, they should take 5,000 or 6,000 at the most.
I used to fill my car with 5,000 liras. Now it needs 10,000. Also, the government is cheating us. Every Wednesday, they fix it at 800. Then they decrease to 200. Then they go back and increase it. This is the work of Signora.
Honestly, we were paying $4 Canadian for the gallon, and that comes out to $1 American for the liter.
For an employee to use more than a third of his salary for gas to get to work and come back is just unreal.
The people's complaints about the gas price increases were shared by the importing companies, confirming that there is no relationship between the local increase and the large consumption during the summer season with the arrival of tourists.
When the price of the barrel was $140 or $147, the tax was zero. There was just a tax on the chemical additives. Today, there's a tax of about 12,000 liras, which is 40% of the price of a container. If this tax didn't exist, then a price of a container would not be 32,000 liras. It would be 12,000. It would decrease by 20,000 liras. By the way, the state pricing system did not take into consideration the additional price increase due to transportation, premium, insurance, and other factors that make up the price. A committee made up of several ministers was formed to examine this subject.
However, the Ministry of Oil does not appear to be indifferent like other companies. In its opinion, the problem is linked to the budget. The people are not capable of coping with the results of the state's mistakes.
The Ministry of Finance, upon a request of the Prime Minister, did a study and discovered that they needed to stabilize the reserves because they needed to know how much their revenues would be for the year. The fuel prices went up again. The reserves stabilized, and then the gas prices went up. Now, as minister, I can't do anything. Anyway, we have employees who deal with this matter. A document comes to the employee, and I can't change one lira.
The problem and the solution began and end in the Ministry of Finance, who declined to comment when we tried to contact them. While waiting for the formation of the government and new tax policies, and while keeping the ministerial committee within the council, prices will continue to increase next week. World oil prices swing back and forth. The one sure thing in the local market is the weekly price increase. The other sure thing is that state taxes and people's complaints will most likely fall on deaf ears. Basil Al-Aridi, New TV.
The rise of food prices during the month of Ramadan has burdened fasting people and spoiled their festivities for this holy month. The rise of food prices and meat has compelled Jordanians to boycott red meat, which has caused an oversupply of meat in the Jordanian markets. Citizens demanded that the government play a larger role in stopping the dramatic increase in food prices by stopping greedy food traders who take advantage of the high food demand during Ramadan. Salwa Al-Salwaka reports from Jordan.
It's as if ordinary citizens are being targeted during the holy month of Ramadan, the month of goodness and blessings. As Ramadan began, food prices increased to unprecedented levels. The inability of people to buy products has caused the products to overflow at the markets. and the price of food that is needed by people who are fasting has increased. But people have no choice but to buy the food to prepare for their fasting families. Citizens attribute the reasons behind the increase in food prices to greedy food traders and lack of government regulation.
The government must find a solution. They must find a solution for the poor people.
The rise in food prices started 2 weeks before Ramadan, and they are still high. Some food items are less expensive, but the quality is compromised.
Jordanians tend to consume large quantities of red meat, but their prices have increased. Now, 1 kilogram of red meat costs $16, which most Jordanian families can't afford. The Consumer Advocate Association called on Jordanians to boycott red meat as a way to bring the prices down. The consumers responded with a wide-scale boycott.
Studies reveal that sales of meat have decreased dramatically in 40% to 60% of butcher shops throughout the kingdom. Of course, consumers benefited from the boycott. This is the first time consumers responded at this level. This tested their ability to make an influence.
I'm a Jordanian citizen, but I've never been able to afford local meats. I've always been forced to eat meats imported from Dubai.
We do not see meat, especially red meat.
Jordanian citizens have been increasingly burdened during this holy month. The greediness of some food traders and the monopoly of some companies has caused food prices to increase. This comes as families also have to deal with the expenses of a new school year, which also coincided with Ramadan. As if this is not enough, people also have to deal with a very hot summer. Regardless of how much food prices increase, ordinary citizens have no choice but to pay, hoping that government regulation will bring down prices to a reasonable level.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.